Okay, today it's D6. We're going to jump ahead of D4, which you're doing a problem for. D5, because it has weird numbers like golden ratios and things like that. D6 is just an outer product of D3 with D2, so the calculations of its characters, irreducible representations, and a lot of other things that we haven't covered yet are really easy. So it's the simple groups that you have to work out first, and then the semi-simple ones that are cross products of the ones you've already done is an important technique because it saves you a lot of work. So I'm going to jump ahead here to that, and after we get done with that, if we do, there's a lot in it that we can spend time on. I want to begin the octahedral tetrahedral systems, and that's basically lecture 19. Showing of the group structure and the characters, work out the class algebras for both T and O, and then begin to see how they're going to split. So since we have the characters, we can predict all of the possible splittings and subgroup chains that you could have, and it's enormous. These things are, by comparison, much more complicated than just D3 or D4. So let me go ahead here and speed ahead. We've already covered a good deal of this, and we ended with studies of correlations and studies of spring matrices and things like that. We ended with the particular subgroup chain that ended with C3 as a subgroup that had to have its members diagonalized at the expense of the other members like I3 that we had used as our main descriptor. So I'm going to be reviewing this, but with a more substantial group that's twice the size, and the one that will give the band spectra that is part of this induced representation idea. And this, I think, today will make that concept clearer than it was from such a simple thing as D3. So that reciprocity theorem will be at work today. Anyway, here it is, hexagonal D family. And remember this chart, that as the order of the group advances, we're going to be advancing from our group of order 6 here, D3 or C3V, to, we're going to skip the 8s, which is the D4 family, and take up the trigonal hexagonal family, which is these guys right here. And we're going to look at D6 in particular. But D6 is isomorphic to, well, basically all of these are isomorphic, but they're very different symmetries as far as the detailed geometry of them goes. So we'll be looking at a comparison between D6 and D3. And basically what we're going to do is we're going to take D3 and cross it with C2 to make D6 and all of its parts. So just to remind you what the group slide rule is, let me turn around here. I don't think I've ever done this before, drew a D2 group slide rule. Remember the four group, the one that's so important for relativity, that would have parity, time reversal, and then the product of those, which is charge conjugation. But here it's just three 180 degree rotations, or three mirror plane reflections. That's getting closer to the physics of the sigma. Sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z are, in a sense, reflections. The idea of having a table that says this is the area where a wave function associated with our starting point is, and then there are the three positions that that wave function could occupy if you applied, say, a rotation by 180 degrees around the x-axis. That would flip the wave function up to there, so that would be the Rx wave function. And then if you wanted to rotate around the this axis right here, Ry, Ry doesn't show up very well there. It is there, believe me. Just is cyaned its way out of existence. The Ry takes this wave function and flops it over to here. So that's the Ry property. That's where the coordinate Ry for the wave function is. And then finally, the actual rotation Rz around this axis that comes out of the screen by 180 takes the wave function that was called 1 and turns it into the wave function that you would call Rz with this group numeration. So that's the simplest example. It's not quite trivial, but it's pretty simple, of the group slide rule. Then here's the one we worked with for D3. Okay, and it consisted of elements that are labeled now with I3. Remember that one that we diagonalized along with 1. Then all of the other elements were not diagonal when we got done calculating their irreducible representation. So these were the selected ones, right, that get to be diagonal and label all the quantum states that you would be making with this. Here is a group that's twice the size. It's D6. So that's what we've got to talk about. We've got to look at these. But there's a slide rule right there. In addition to having I1 axis, an I2 axis, and an I3 axis that's generating the subgroup D3 that lives inside this set. In addition to that, and also in addition to the rotation here, R, okay, R to the first power, or R to the second power, which I haven't drawn here, in addition to that, we're going to have twice as many rotations that have start off with half the angle. So this first rotation here is by 60 degrees. This one here, that's h squared, r equal h squared. That's this r right here. So you can see that we have also another 380 degree axis of rotation, J3 right here, and J2 right here, and J1 over here. Okay, so this is all going to be shown very clearly on the next slide. So that's really the topic for this particular part of our thing. Now remember, this is some mathematical symbolism. Basically, this is D6H, the big guy here. Because there's a line going to this one, that means that this one contains that one. Well, it's kind of unfortunate. They picked the contain symbol to point backwards if you're thinking of a C. But a better way to think about that symbol is greater than. Yeah, greater than is just that, right? I'll just curve it. Okay? So this is the greater group than that one. That means this is a subgroup of that group. Okay? Then that is a subgroup of this group. And then inside that guy is both C3 and C2. I didn't bother to draw the C3, but we'll be making the point of that. In any case, you see all of that happening right here. This thing has a subgroup C3. It also has a subgroup C2. So this map is, you know, helpful for doing that. These things. Now, what's interesting about D6? And my gosh, I guess maybe I've forgotten to put a line. But D6H does show D2. It's also a subgroup D2. You should go to that one. Just noticed that this afternoon. And we'll talk about that in a minute here. So this group is in there too. This is a pretty loaded group. So let's go ahead and look at a picture of both the group and the potential system that I'm thinking of. It's very similar to what we had before. I'm just imagining that there's some barriers located on the axes that have these rotations, I1, I2, and I3, and I3 is on a straight line that goes through to that I3 right there. So turning this thing on the ends, we get this picture here. In any case, these are barriers, and then these are the wells in which the wave would live if it was confined to a circle. All right? And you have, in addition to the operations of D3 here, okay, those are the six operations of D3, you have all of those operations multiplied by a rotation by 180 degrees around the z-axis, a C2 group that's associated with this axis right here. We don't usually call that operation RZ, although that's a choice of symbols that we'll use for the 180 around Z when we get to the octahedral and tetrahedral groups. But come down here, and what we're going to name it is this hexagonal rotation Q. Now remember, we had a operation that rotates by 120 degrees, and the h squared is just r. And then h to the fourth, which is this thing right here, and of course you probably name it by its complement, it's minus h minus 2 power. But anyway, r squared is h fourth, as it's listed here. Okay. So the hexagonal primary rotation is h. That's a 60 degree one. R is 120. This one's a finer element. It does less, and therefore can be part of a larger group. So here are all of the rotations around the z-axis that this group contains. And that means h to the zeroth power, but here's 2 and 4. And then 3 and 5 show up here. And that's kind of interesting, because what I'm doing here is I'm taking 120 and tacking on 180 to that. And that makes a hexagonal 5. That's this guy right here, which is just hexagonal minus 1. So on this C6 cyclic structure, these guys, this would be h to the minus 1, this would be h to the minus 2, and then h to the 3 is equal to h to the minus 3. Then there's 2 and 1, and of course the identity, the 0, is not shown on that diagram. Does that make some sense of how this is put together, at least as far as this z-axis goes? Then there are only 180 degree axes perpendicular to that. And basically it just boils down to our eyes, as we know and love from D3, are rotations around the faces of the hexagon. There's face, right? And then the J's, you see the I3 comes through to the other side, I1 comes through to the other side. It's a two-sided axis, okay? When you don't have fermions, right? When you do have it, there's a minus sign on the other side, right? Anyway, the J's, J1, J2, and J3 are 180-degree rotations around the corners of vertices of the hexagon, the way we've drawn it here. Yeah.
Can you not differentiate those two by looking at how many atoms are not moved?
Well, we haven't said where the atoms are. I'm more saying where the potential structure is. I would presume that the atoms, if they were attractive, would be in the neighborhood of the J axes, mm-hmm. and there'd be empty space with the I axis. But that doesn't have to be. There could be repulsive things at the I, if you believe this potential. Obviously, you can change the potential to anything you want that has six-fold symmetry. So we are not yet saying exactly where we're going to put the things that make the repulsion or the attraction or what that is, but the demonstration that I've got set up just for the quantum mechanics is a set of six barriers. They're really high. So we're going to be talking about tunneling effects for this. These are what are called tight band models. Now, I don't know if that answered the question you were after.
I think I'll ask it again a little later.
Okay, because when we actually put this in the mechanical spring model, then it's, you know, a little easier to say where things are. And obviously there the axes are going to be on the thing that's moving, the mass, and there's six masses. Got another finger here, right. Now, well, no, this note is important right here. The flippers, that's the I's and the J's, do not flip over the potential plot. I mean, you could say, well, if I turn it over, the particles are all going to fall out onto the floor. Right? No, that's not the way it works. There's no gravity. There's just the attraction of the valleys and the repulsion. And I happen to be plotting the potential here as a function of another coordinate, z, that is indicating where the repulsion is and where the attraction is when it's low. Is that, that's something that can easily screw you up when you look at pictures like this. We're going to flip this over. This is all rotations, no reflections here. It might have been easier to do C6V, but I figured we ought to do as many of things we can with the rotations before we get into those groups that have mirror planes and reflection rotations. There are all kinds of weird elements that we haven't.
If one side did flip, I mean, then it wouldn't have that symmetry there, right? It would break.
Yeah.
I mean, if you turn it into a peak to a valley, I mean, it would definitely change.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good point. Yeah. Okay, so let's see if there's anything in this next one that I need. Basically, what we need to note is what it means to have a cross product. And it's just called that, the cross product, but it's really should be named Cartesian product, which is really set theory, but it works for groups. The thing that has to happen before you can call this a cross product, a direct product, as opposed to a semi-direct product, which is kind of a, as far as I can see, not a terribly useful thing, but may turn out later that it is, I don't know. But anyway, what is required is that every element here commute with every element here. Well, there's only one element here that's in question that could possibly not commute. But I definitely want the 180-degree rotation to commute with all of these guys. And it is true that 180-degree rotations in a bosonic set, not a fermionic setting, but in the usual classical setting, 180-degree rotations around perpendicular axes commute. Now you can check this a number of ways. Probably the better way to do it is to look at Hamilton's turns, but we're going to skip that one. In any case, D2 is an abelian group, and it consists of X rotation by 180, Z rotation by 180, and Y rotation by 180. Okay, so that's a subgroup of this group right here. And where are three rotations that might commute? There's one of them, there's another, and then there's this guy around the z-axis. So it's basically x by 180, y by 180, and z by 180. Those all three are commute. Those are the only ones that might have caused us trouble. Okay. So there, those guys all there commute with RZ. Okay, they're all perpendicular to RZ. but not to each other, separated by 120 degrees. And then there isn't anything else except the identity. So we're okay. This is a valid outer product. And that's part of group theory, though, is worrying about that stuff. Okay? And so here they all are written with the notation that we'll use here. When I take the I1 and multiply it by Rz, I get J1. That means that J1 is perpendicular to both I1 and Rz. Or it wouldn't have worked. This wouldn't have worked. Okay? So that there's little subgroups D2 in here that made of these three rotational, or these three 180-degree rotations, or these three. Okay? So this thing's loaded with D2s. It's got a lot of structure. All right. See if there's anything else I need to say. I think that's good enough. Well, let me just real quickly remind you of the simplest outer product, and that is the outer product of C2 with C2 that gives D2. We already talked about this one. That means I take the character table of C2, Z, say, or X, that's what I put on the upper there, and then a character table for a rotation around Y, okay? And bingo, I produce the entire group, which includes the product Rx times Ry, which is Rz, right? That's the way it works with D2, okay? So by putting these two character tables in a matrix Cartesian product, I produce a character table in, you know, seconds, right? Not minutes or hours. Seconds, okay? And when you're given a new group and asked to make irreducible representations, it could be your entire life figuring that out, or it could be an hour. You know, there's no limit to the time. In fact, you may have to generate new techniques to find the characters of some of the groups that come up in physics as this field grows. And anyway, what you see there, after you've taken this set of numbers and put it next to this number, that's this part right here, then you take this set of numbers and put it next to that number, same thing, and again, right there, okay? And then finally, you take this set of numbers and put it next to the minus, okay? These three squares are the same. And then there's this one, which is just minus the other three. Okay? Now what I like to do is whenever I see a new group theory book, I look to see if they've done this. Because you can obviously permute this any way you want, right? And you don't always get it to look like that. But the outer product is exposed. Otherwise, it would be mixed up and you wouldn't see it maybe. Okay, so that's an important point. And then the question is, how do you label these things? And here is the kind of labeling, the A and the B. And basically A stands for, this is just my mnemonic, okay? But these are standard notations for almost all of the literature that deals with the groups of solids, molecules, or various atomic structures and fields. The A stands for always the same, and B stands for back and forth. Well, always the same with respect to what? Well, always the same with, in this case, respect to, and we're doing the Y as the primary rotation that isn't going to be Z, which is the one that's usually chosen to become this one, is not this one. But that's the that one. You see, for always the same, I get a 1. And then when it's back and forth, as I go through the R to 180, when I get to 180, I put a minus down, then I come back again, I put a plus. Okay, so that's the C2 effect of Ry being shown by the character table. Okay? And then this one right here, the X thing, that's if this is the y that you're looking at, then there's an x perpendicular to that that's also going to be either even or odd. And when it's even, it's given a 1 subscript, and it's odd, it's given a 2 subscript, and that follows down here as well. So you can have a symmetric always the same, an anti-symmetric always the same, then you can have a back and forth a symmetric, and you can have a back and forth that is anti-symmetric. And then when you get done doing that, you don't need a third one for the label, it's just a product. This times this gives that. Okay, so you don't bother having another label to tell you what the parity is with respect to the main rotation RZ. Now this little game, we're going to play that over and over again in all of these outer products that have C2 factors. So far so good. So I say note common notation, very important in order to read the literature. And I'm talking about chemical physics and chemical literature when I do that. Oh, it's also optics. People in optics are finally learning group theory. It's about time, isn't it? Okay, so now I want to show a subgroup of D6 that's really important. That's C6. We've already worked C6. We did a lot with that. Worked a complete set of eigenvalues in terms of group parameters. Went all the way to the point where we had a situation where the spectra was completely split into 6 levels in terms of 6 parameters. And that was an orthocomplete solution to a group theoretical system that involves a regular representation. So we're going to be doing that again here with D6, but it's not abelian. So here I have C2, which consists of 180 degree rotation. That's the notation that I'm just putting on it right now. That was the thing that was called, will be called H cubed. But these characters here have to be multiplied by all of these characters. So I take this one here and put it on this thing. That's this box right here. I take this one and put it on this box. Same thing. Again, okay, with this one on this box. So this box, and this box are the same because they're coming out of this particular C2. And then finally, a minus times all of those things. Bingo. So here you have a complete set of characters for this abelian group, C6. Every one of them is one-dimensional. Okay? And then the question is, you know, how do I label this thing right here? And that I'm going to kind of leave for you as a problem. Why would I call all of these 0 mod 6, 2 mod 6, and 4 mod 6? That's our labeling, right? But it doesn't go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like we had, right? That order has been changed. All the even stuff comes first, the odd stuff comes second, and backwards. Now if I tell you the answer, you'll never remember it. So this is something that you should do. Figure out why that's 3, why that's 5, why that's 1. Okay, and that means minus 1 is here, right? And 3 is the same as minus 1. And this is minus 2, right? Mod 6. So it's 2 minus 2, minus 1, 1. And then this is 3 is equal to minus 3 mod 6. So just go and take an exponential with the numbers that are associated with these rotations. That's the other thing. I don't go with 60 as my first rotation. That's the way most tables would come. They would break it up with this particular factoring. But this I have 0, 120, 240, and that's minus 120 of the C3 group. And then here's the extra operations, not in the order that you'd expect, but 180 first, and then minus 60 next, and finally 60, which is the main H operation of our group D6 that we're going to take on here. Okay. So I won't answer any questions about that, other things. That's something that lets you think about it. And so here, I'm doing the next obvious thing to do, given that we want D6, not just C6. And so here I'm putting together an outer product of D3 and C2. And I should mention that the outer products are different groups if the numbers associated with them, in this case 2 and 3, 2 and 3, are relatively prime. That has to be in order for the cross product to give you a different group. C2 cross C2 gives you D2. Okay? That's a different group from C4. Okay? Very different. Has complex values. D2 does not. Okay? They're not relatively prime. Right. The same number. But you can't have a common factor shared by the two numbers in a cross product. Another sort of problem to think about. Okay, so here's what goes. We already have a labeling for this D3 group, the 1 and 2 that go on the A representation. Okay, A being a scalar, that's one-dimensional, okay, is either A1 when this is positive, A2 for when that's negative. So 180 is the thing to determine the parity label, E1 and E2. And then this is just called E most of the time. I put E1 here because I want to make a point that when we go to larger groups, such as this thing right here, I'm going to have an E1 and an E2, and they are very different. One of them is quadrupole, the other is dipole. So get used to putting indices on all of the old-fashioned letter number labels of these groups. And that's hard to get familiar with. You know, I had to keep looking it up and reworking it when I first learned this stuff. Anyway, this is the cross product here, where I take all the numbers in this character table, okay, once again, multiply them by 1, that's this, multiply them by another 1, that's this, multiply by the third 1, that's this, and finally by minus 1, this set of numbers is here, okay? So right away you notice that I've got here 1, 2, 3, 4 single-dimension irreducible representations that are orthogonal to each other in the way the characters are orthogonal. And we talked only a little bit about that, but the projectors, of course, are what we're really talking about. You know how those things get to be orthogonal or idempotent. And then we've got the E2 here and the E1 down here. So the big guy comes first, and finally at the end here I have the E1. And that literally means, now, what's associated with angular momentum 1? When we did the character analysis of angular momentum 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 atoms, SPDF orbitals, the first one we looked at that was not trivial was the L equal 1. And that's where this guy would go. At least there'd be two components of it. There's a third component that would be one of these guys, or this guy, depends on how labeling is done and how your coordinates are set. But then this one is angular momentum 2, so that's why I call it a quadrupole representation of this group. Okay, now you can see that this is the group D3 here. This is the group D3 here multiplied by the operator RZ, okay, which gives us these guys. The H cubed is what this thing really is called, hexagonal 60 degrees, times 3 to the third power is 180 degrees. And then there's this guy, which is a 60 degree, and this guy's a minus 60 degree. and they are in partner with the D3 operators that are 120 and minus 120. And then the J's are just those guys that aren't I's. There are 180 degree rotations around other axes. And basically it's the x-axis and the y-axis for the third one of these, the one that will be choosing them to be the diagonal by default, if we're, that will come out of doing this particular cross product. But there are a lot of other choices. This is a big group, and a lot of ways to split it. Okay, now, once again, the A's and the B's, okay? A for always the same versus back and forth. The question is, what's going always the same? What's going back and forth? And again, sometimes when people make textbooks in group theory, they don't know this inner structure. They just say, these are numbers, I put them anywhere that works. So it'll be up to you when you use the literature to straighten those people out and fix it so you can read the answers to what is the numbers mean. Now, when you flip J3, okay, now this is a whole class here. That's the other thing about this, is that these classes, these groups right, these two elements right here are plus or minus 60 degrees, just like these two are plus or minus 120. But they're the same rotation as far as this group is concerned, because it has the symmetry operators that flip it over. And when you flip a positive rotation by 120 over, it becomes a negative rotation by 120, right? So these guys transfer these into each other, therefore they are in the same class with respect to this group. And so it's true for the 60 and minus 60. Okay? These guys and these guys, flip them over. Okay? And then this guy's in a class by himself. Nobody can do anything. It's on z-axis, nobody's moving that. It goes this way, it's the same as going this way, right? Plus and minus 180, same thing. If you're dealing with non-fermionic problem, right? Something that doesn't have a Pauli anti-symmetry, something that is classical or Bose symmetry.
So this will have a dual cover as well?
You bet. Yeah, they all do. And of course, when we make the Hamilton turn diagram for this, which is in the text, I haven't bothered to put it out here, you see where the minuses and where the pluses are on that very clearly. Now, what might be worthwhile is figure out a way to cleanly to make use of the Hamilton thing that can do both boson and fermion and put it on this diagram. But I haven't been terribly successful with that. The rules that kind of get in each other's way that I have been able to put down so far, but I haven't really tried hard enough, I don't think. Anyway, this is the guy right here, the 60 degree rotation. This is, if you're thinking of a hexagonal structure as a lattice, which then repeats itself over and over again, if you're thinking of it that way, then this is the main translation, and this is the main translation backwards. One-step translation. It's the smallest rotation that this hexagonal thing has, and therefore it is the primitive translation, if you're thinking of that as a translation from one well to the next, to the next, to the next, and there are six wells here. Or six barriers, either way. But most of the time the wave function lives in the wells, so that's what we talk about, is its symmetry. And the basic idea is that when you do this and it's always the same, then you get an A on it. When you do it and it's flipped, you put a B on it. So that's where the A and the B go. The A versus B sub parity. The parity also is plus or minus. but that's this thing, that's the Y rotation, the flip over. Okay, the flip over determines whether it's a something 1 or a something sub 2. Okay, and you'll see there's the 1 that goes with that 1, there's the minus 1 that goes with that 2. Then that 2 shows up here, so it's easy to get that ordering wrong, and then B1 is due to that 1 plus 1 there. So even odd as far as the flip goes. Okay? And then you can play games by noticing that the product of this and this is that, etc. Okay, this times this is that. You know, that checks your table. And, you know, no matter how many times these tables have been written in various books, I almost always have an error because the people haven't gone to the trouble of taking the thing apart to check the numbers. So that's what you'll have to do if you want to get things right all the time. All right. Now, here's the big deal
question
about this, is that I can go ahead
harder
and build representations with this.
Sorry, here's a question.
If you have like the group, like C2Y...
back up here.
If you have like the group C2Y up there, and you do the Cartesian product, you will have the same coefficients, right?
C2Z.
What I'm asking is, what if you have like C2Y or C2X, you will have the same coefficients, right?
Oh, you have to be careful because the this particular C2X is very special, right? All of the other C2 axes, you see, are lying in the plane with each other. This is unique, the Z.
So it wouldn't make sense. They probably would be all zero, or?
That's the axis right there. That's the 180 degree rotation right there. That's what we got when we took 1 times RZ. Mm-hmm. RZ is synonymous with the H cubed, because H is 60, right? And 63rd power is 180, but it's the main 180. It's very special, this guy. It's in its class by itself, right?
You spoke of those commuting with the original or the base group. If you chose R sub Y, it wouldn't commute with each and every one of those original classes.
No, that's true. Any of these guys here are going to have trouble commuting with the operations that are not 180.
Okay.
Right?
Because they all lie in the same plane.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay.
No, but that's a good question. This is this is a unique part of the of this factor, because this is a unique factor right here. The other C2s are not so good. The name that's given to this for a group theorist is a normal subgroup. And this is a good example. I'm glad you asked that question, because this is I always wondered, what's normal about it? Well, can you show me an abnormal group? Well, yes you can, but what normal means is that that group is on a line normal to most of the others. Well, in fact, all of the others. The other subgroups, like I2 and 1, okay? When I go to transform those, they move. If I do a I3 operation of that thing, it comes over here. But if I do any operation with any of these operators on Mr. Normal, nothing happens. It's still in that direction. Sure, you can flip the sign, but flipping the sign of 180 degrees doesn't do anything. H minus 3 is equal to H plus 3 power. Does that make sense? Yeah. So that's really what's special about that subgroup, this guy plus this guy. Okay? Any other good questions? These are all important things that are part of the understanding of this crazy stuff. All right. And this is where we take the representations that we already know for D3 that we got by making sure that I3 was diagonal. And of course, when you make I3 diagonal, none of the other matrices except the identity turn out diagonal. Full. All right. So I take this thing here, and I just put it here again, and I put it here again, and then I put it here all with minus signs. Done. Okay? So instead of spending 3 days on this, it's a few minutes. Right? Just as fast as you can write it down, you got a complete table of irreducible representation. Now you can use the formula for the projection operators. And it's now that you would probably be a good idea, just to make things easier for you, to take the cosets of the group that's determining this thing, that's the cosets associated with these guys here, the ones that are diagonal, okay, to make the cosets of those subgroups, those diagonal subgroups, and write the projection operators in that order, the factored order, according to cosets. I make that point because we're going to be seeing that, particularly for the cubic group. That's going to be the main job we have to do
as we go through that. Diagonal in this?
Pardon?
What did you mean by diagonal?
When we're talking about multi-dimensional, that is more than one dimension, right? Which E2 and E1 are, okay, then we're able to, crush any representation down to these, but we cannot crush all 12 of these any further. I could go and find a transformation that would diagonalize that one and maybe a couple of others, right? As soon as I did these things go pop, and they wouldn't be diagonal anymore in that basis. So we have compressed these representations onto the diagonal as pretty much as best you can.
And so those are all of those. That's why it says EREPs for this. So the Cartesian products automatically give you those when you do certain orders of those products.
Well, because it is this, and everything here commutes with everything here, I can put them together that way, whether they can, the actual matrices commute with each other.
Oh, because they're abelian anyway, so they would automatically give you diagonal.
Yeah. Yeah, the subgroups are abelian. The subgroup just consisting of these three here, but you don't include those, because these guys don't commute with these guys. But these two commute very nicely. They're just powers. And then you find a couple down here that commute with each other pretty nicely. They're just inverses of each other. You always commute with your inverse. Okay, at this point, once you have these guys, you can look at the correlations. You can look at what happens when I take this representation here and just keep J3, okay? So the only matrices that I keep right here is a C2 subgroup consisting of 1 and J3, okay? That's kind of an interesting thing to do, right? So I can see here is a 1 and a minus 1, and it's already reduced for me. So I know this guy's symmetric and that's anti-symmetric in this basis. You see, this is a very special basis that we worked hard to get, right? We worked hard to get this because it's D3's basis, and we made sure that I3 was diagonal, and using it, its projectors, on the all-commuting projectors for this D3. And that split it into projectors that give these matrices. That wasn't the whole story, remember. We got the splitting into the rank, which was 4. Then we had to find 2 more projectors, right, that were nilpotent. These guys were idempotent, right? So these guys all come in with each other, right? Then these guys spoil that game real fast. They don't come in with each other, and they don't come in with any of these guys, right? I should take that back again. They do come in with PA1, and they do come in with PA2, right? But they don't come in with any of the E's. So that's what we did to get all these numbers. Now we just shove them into this thing and get it for a group that's twice the size. And when you lay out all its properties, it's 4 times the size. The difficulty of storing data for groups goes up as a square of the order. And please do check that the sum of the squares of the dimension is equal to the order of this group. The order of this group is 12, and we've got 1 squared plus 1 squared plus 2 squared, and then we got it again, that's 12. Okay, so that's something else you want to make sure. The character table satisfies that. Whatever the first column gives you, and that most people will put those numbers in the first column. So when you're talking about a character table like this, okay, 1 squared plus 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 1 squared plus 1 squared plus 2 squared, better equal to the order of this group, okay, which is 6 plus 6, 12. Now with an outer product, that's pretty trivial, but for other groups that are made, that aren't semi-simple like this one, that is a piece of the literature, so to speak. Okay, now, this is just looking and saying, how does A1 relate to this is D6, and I'm looking at a subgroup here. Actually, what I'm looking at right here is C6. This is not C3, this is C6. Then here I'm looking at C2, odd or even, and that's the one that I really am interested in here. But this one's interesting too. It's pretty obvious what happens here is E2 is going to split. If I were to diagonalize E2, now E2 is this guy right here, okay? And what I'm going to be doing is finding a way to diagonalize thing just as a subgroup of these elements right here. Those three come in with each other, so I could have diagonalized that instead of this guy. But when I do that transformation, I will flip this thing to anti-diagonal, and these guys right here will become diagonal. Okay. And if I'm just considering that subgroup, that subgroup right there would be C3, then I would see let's see, what was I saying here, I would see the E here split into a 2 mod 6 and a 4 mod 6. That's plus and minus 2 modulo 6. And then this guy right down here is going to split into 1 mod 6 and 5 mod 6. That's plus and minus 1 modulo 6. So these two, the vector and the tensor, are going to be splitting up into 1s and plus and minus 1s, and the quadrupole is going to split in plus and minus 2. Then it's just a matter of figuring out what the other guys are. The B's, the back and forth, obviously, are connected to 3 mod 6. That's called the Brillouin band boundary. Another reason for having a B. It's back and forth, but it's also BBB, Brillouin's band boundary. We have a band, and they're going to be, these guys are going to hold the E levels inside them. And then the regular band boundary is going to be A's, A1s and A2s. That's what the band we'll see in a few minutes here. Okay. So that's what happens when you let the waves run free around the six-fold playground, so to speak. You let the C, this is, I remember, this is C6, not C3, maybe make a note of that. It's a bad typo there. When you're in the six, going around with not too much interference, low barriers, okay, then you're going to see doublets, okay? Some of the doublets will be absolute. Others will have little tiny gaps. So this is a gap. That's going to be a gap. between those two, but this is going to be a doublet that carries current, if you like. These guys, they sometimes degenerate and can carry a funny kind of current, but it's weird. They don't like to carry current. They like to stand still and be symmetric, or stand still and be anti-symmetric. So these are all pieces of physical information that if you've done the tabulation of characters and subduction table, the correlation table, it's very powerful. Now, what we're interested in pretty much today is the opposite case, where the local symmetry of the wells dominates. So I'm interested in just having the symmetry associated with a C2 group, a J3, an I3, it turns out I don't care too much, but I'm just interested in something that can only be even or odd in that little well, okay? And the A's will become symmetric. I'm sorry, the 1's will become symmetric. There's an A1 becoming symmetric. Here's a B1 becoming symmetric. And the A2 will become anti-symmetric. Now this is with respect to rotation around that well, which means you're flipping the whole crystal over, which is one of our flips here, J3 in particular. This guy down at the end here, okay? It has that 1 and 2 as a plus and minus. Okay. So, what I'll be seeing then is this thing not splitting. I'll get both even and odd together, degenerate, and the same with this right here. Okay, now, remember that I said that if you read these tables backwards, you get some information. It's really quite cool. And that is, you get a feeling for the structure all the way up the energy scale. If I'm talking about something that has 0 mod 6 and I let it propagate throughout the crystal lattice, all 6 lattices get to feel this thing. And remember, the reason for symmetry being important is that when you have symmetry, then you have identical energies, identical frequencies. So I'm wiggling here, and I keep the tune, I keep the timing, okay, as well as any of the others, whatever that timing is, okay, for that particular level. They're all able to keep that beat. They don't get out of phase. So that means if I sit here and ring and ring and ring and ring, finally, my neighbors are going to start to wake up and start singing at the same frequency. Okay? And as soon as they wake up, then the guys next to them are going to feel very weak because it's a huge barrier, okay, and it's exponential tunneling that you talk about inside, right? And then finally, the whole place, you see, will be up, jumping up and down with some kind of phasing. It depends on, you know, a lot of things. What happens if you start one in one place and then remember all those crazy diagrams in space and time where you had a number, you know, various fairy sums, right, making big splashes and other things, other fairy sums, not so much.
The revivals?
Right, exactly. You're going to have a revival dance with those 6. And this one right here, if you start with this guy, start with something that's symmetric, then the dance will include an A1, an E1, I'll go in order here, A1, E1, E2, and B1. In other words, all the 1s are going to start singing because they've got the right symmetry too. That's the other thing that's important for resonance. And then all the anti-symmetric ones, if you get one of these going, they're going to all start singing. So that's what we're going to look for. We're going to look for the states that are involved in how many levels, okay? 1, 2, 3, it's a degenerate. 3, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is another degeneracy. So 6 separate places are going to have participation in this dance. Now, if it's if you're talking about a particular state, say 0 mod 6 or 1 mod 6, it's all tied to the 6. That's a wave function sitting in a 6. Well, it doesn't do much. All it can get excited is its A partner. Not very big party, just 2, but sometimes, 3's a crowd, right? So these can be the strongest. It involves a whole darn ring resonating back and forth. And then if it's this one, well, that's kind of sad because it just becomes a single E1, okay? This one right here, well, sorry, it just becomes an E2 degenerate. Okay. What does this one become? Oh, it's a pair again, okay? The bees, okay, the back and forth guys. Or girls, guy, girl, okay? We'll forget about all the transgender stuff. We'll get to that later.
Large group.
And the 4 right here, okay? That's, mod 6, okay, what we're talking about. 4, it just is this guy, E2. And then finally this guy is just E1 again. So this is what you're going to see in the spectrum that we'll show. And this is true for the quantum, but also that classical bid spring, 6 masses doing their dance. It's a mechanical analog of quantum mechanics. Okay, so here's a picture of what you would have if you were deep in the well and you're looking at, and here is the 0 A1 wave function. Okay, now these are something that I can't do on the web, but we can do on the screen here. So I'm going to go ahead and bring that up, and then we'll talk about the vibrational part that's analogous to this. So let me first of all get it up on a screen here and get it started. And eventually we will have this on the web, but this is part of Borat, it's just not the modern Borat. But here, I think I can show that to you fairly quickly here. Let's see if it goes. Okay, so there is the A1 state of a really tight band. In that energy region, just a few pixels apart is an A1's the lowest, and that's an interesting theorem that Schrodinger proved, was that you always pay for nodes. So this wave essentially has no nodes at all. If I slow this thing down so it doesn't go so fast, you can see the real part and the imaginary part. The zeros are infinitely fast everywhere at one moment, and then they're gone. There are no nodes. Mm-hmm. Now you might say it's quasi-node. That's just because the barrier is very high. Okay? So that's that one. Now, let's look. And these are moving waves, these E guys here. These guys... I'm going to zero this guy out, and I'm going to start just the minus 1 E. Let's do the plus 1 first, because everyone's used things to go right. You can see that's a moving wave. It's here, 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 and now it's back again. So it's going around the circle, okay? That's a moving wave. That's complex. That's what I get if I diagonalize the H1 and H2, H first power, H the second power, or, that's all we've got right here. I'm going to go to H to the second power and the fourth power in the next trial here. But obviously I could take a combination of those things, for example, like this. And I'm going to see if I can make this happen. without too much trouble, and make a standing wave. That's pretty good standing wave right there. With just one wave. There it's up, there it's down, see? And then, of course, it's phase, it's going. But notice the outside is not moving. This is a stationary state. Any combination of these two is a stationary state. Okay? Sine or cosine. I can make the lump come to the center, or I can make it have a node, or I can put it, you know, anywhere, just by adjusting the phase of one of the inputs here. Okay? Just move it like this, and I move where the wave will be. And it just sits there and goes up and down. No current. It's quenched. It's called quenching. Okay? And the next stop is E2. Let's do E2 plus first. Kind of hard to see what's going on in this one. It really helps to make it into a standing wave. So I'll try to do that now. I'll couple these two opposite each other just to see. An example, that's about right there, I think. That's standing wave. It's two sine subwaves making up the band. Okay, you're ready for back and forth number two. Let's see if we can get that going. Zero it out. Let her go. Okay, if I pause this thing. It's forth, back, forth, and back, forth, and back. Okay, that's the B. Okay. Now this one is two, that's a even. And the problem is here, I've used the barrier to indicate whether it's odd or even. This one is very even in the thing, so really B1 is what this one should have been if I'd been careful with where the origin was consistent with this. So it should be A1, E1, E2, B1, and then this should be a B2. Now you can see the splitting here very nicely for that one. So let's go get that just for the heck of it here. But I should have you notice something, and that is, let's go back to the original thing here. I'm going to zero everything, zero, erase. I'm going to go ahead and start this one, which is a lowest frequency mode, and then I'm going to add to that. This is pausing it, so I can turn on, say, the moving wave right here. Okay, so now what I've got is big lump here because I've added this thing, which was always the same, to this one, which is a cosine of one whole revolution here, and let that one go and just wait, and you'll see that it's creeping. It's doing multiple barrier tunneling. See how it's shrinking here? This is not a stationary state. It's a very sluggish state, but it's not stationary. It's going to be beating at the frequency associated with a fraction of a pixel splitting right there. This is a good quantum lesson here. You've got to be aware that in nuclei there are things that sit there and wiggle you know, with the outside for hundreds of years, and then all of a sudden, bam, the alpha particle comes out. There's no limit to the time scales for these exponential barriers that exist in quantum mechanics. You can have a system where it would take 100 years to do what it's doing here in just a few minutes, moving from one place to the next. Because when you get down in a barrier, it goes down real fast. This is what you're usually working with, but here's what you're working with deep inside, tight binding. Isn't that wild? Well, these guys up here are not so sluggish. They've got lots of splitting. So as soon as I put two of these together, I'm going to see some good transverse motion here, the translational motion. But look at it, it's not even halfway done yet. It's been puffing away here for at least a minute or so. Okay? So, I gotta get the right mouse. Let's kill this one. Zero. Okay. Let's just hop up and add these two together. First of all, what does this one look like? This is a B1. Okay. I would call that a B2 because it's got a plus and minus a node in the center. Okay. So if I put my origin, you know, this is measured relative to the barrier, not to the well. So B1 is correct in that sense, okay? And then the thing that we're going to partner that with, we're going to put simultaneously excitation with, will be, let's go ahead and zero this one out and just start and see if you can see what it looks like. It's a pretty complicated way because now we're getting two quanta instead of one quanta. And it's pretty hard to see the two in that. If I zero that and do a one, it's a little easier to see because it's just an E1 behavior. It's not terribly easy to see there, but it is a cosine. A sort of a wave. That's not a very good example because it is so close to the top here. But let's go ahead and start the B1 and a little bit of E2 going to the right. See, it moves a lot faster. See the thing creeping this way. In just a few seconds, this one has gone what this one took a minute or so to do. And it's just proportional to the splitting right here. This one's about 7 pixels. This one is more like 1 pixel or less. So this thing is 7 or 8 times faster. Isn't group theory fun? Actually, it has physics attached to it. Now, the one that's weird is the Bragg reflection. You heard of Bragg reflection? These two together do that. Zero her out. Let's get old B1 going. So that's stationary state. Add any other state, it's not stationary anymore, and this one is really... Look what happens to the energy level when I add these two. It goes, tries to make an energy that is halfway between the energies of those guys. Okay? And it's not really phase-dependent, but it is amplitude-dependent. Da-da, 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 da-da. Right? That's Bragg reflection. It starts going one way, and then it turns around and goes the other way. And you see another one up here between A1 and A2, and both of them then start over again.
So that oscillation and that wave is not moving in one direction, it's moving in two directions, right?
I mean, it starts to go this way, and then says, uh-oh, and Bragg reflects, and goes the other way immediately. Now, if we bring these two together, if we take, I wish this one was a little bit closer, when you get up in the higher regions of this thing, and I can just reduce the potential to see that, we'll bring these two together and you'll see the thing go for a while and then go and then turn around and go back this way like that. That's called a galloping, by me anyway, Bragg reflection. Let's go ahead and do that.
What quantum phenomena would that wave describe?
Pardon?
What quantum phenomena will that?
Well, you just shine either a sound or a light or a combination of light and sound, that's a plasmon or a polaron, sorry, into a lattice. And it can go, you know, quite a way in, maybe hundreds of lattice spacings, and then it says, hey, I don't like this. It comes right back out. And that's the way you do X-ray crystallography, is you look at the Bragg reflection peaks for a crystal. And it isn't just out and back, it's in and go off some angle, and the angles are preferred according to the symmetry of the crystal. So the way people tell what crystals are, they shine X-rays at them. So the X-rays have wavelengths that's comparable to that of the lattice spacing. And you get resonances all over the place. And we're just looking at a really extreme case of Bragg reflection.
Set up that other scenario, because it really...
Pardon?
It set up that other scenario. I believe you were going to lower the well...
Yes, let's do that.
Science.
What I'll do is I will reset the potential parameters. I've got a 66 for that top of the thing. I'm going to cut that down to, you know, roughly half of that. And we should be able to see some Bragg reflection off of that. Let's try it.
It'll sit there.
There we go. Now you can see, first of all, anything I do mixing now is going to go pretty fast down here. But what I want to do is go up, and let's go ahead. This one's good enough. Mm-hmm. They're about the same splitting. This should be slow here. A slow Bragg reflection, reasonably slow. Let's see how that goes. So I will zero. And we'll be doing a stationary state of A2, that's always the same, but with a 1. And then I'm going to do this other guy here, this other A1, and get something that starts to move one way, and then turns around. See it coming toward me now? And then it says, ah, crap on this. Gallops the other way. It says, oh, I didn't want to go that way, and come on back. Isn't that wild?
At some point they have the same frequency, right?
Well, the frequency of this motion, that is, how long does it take to repeat, okay, it depends on the period associated with this beat frequency right here. So take that frequency, invert it, multiply by 2 pi, and you've got your period, right? This is angular frequency, you've got your period that way. Period of the Bragg reflection dance. That's definitely galloping there. What's funny about this is these waves go when there's a big standing wave ratio.
Kind of doing a zoo thing.
Yeah. So that's a pretty good example of that. And there are all kinds of other experiments that people don't talk about much that we can do with this, because we can go ahead and say, what happens if I pick the ground state down here, which, you know, just very sleepy, right, and add this B1, or B2 is what it's written there, to it, okay? Now they take turns putting all of massing every other well this way, and then it turns around and puts all the particles in the odd wells. Indeed. So I think that, you know, the real value of these apps is it takes you away from the algebra for a while, right? And you can start seeing what's really possible. It jogs you into thinking about, you know,
what
would I make
projections
some...
mean, the A, B, C?
Pardon?
Because when you do pick those states, you're picking which of those block matrices you're really diagonalizing to get those states to show up.
Well, remember that the blocks, the blocks consisted of two-dimensional blocks, which these are part of. They're the basis for the two-dimensional blocks. But these are just one-dimensional. The A1, or the B1, A2, and B2, they don't like to live in sin together. They finally will when you go really high, you go to heaven, right? These gaps, that's what they are, the gaps in the band. The band is, these are the band boundaries, these B's and A's, okay? There's the band. Only got two states in the band, right? But if we put, you know, 100 wells here, you'd have 50 pairs, roughly speaking, in between these band boundaries. Okay, so when you go to heaven, these things get very close. So they're also very nearly doubly degenerate. These are exactly doubly degenerate, but these are only approximately doubly degenerate. They have tiny gaps up there, so it takes them a long time to Bragg reflect. So, you know, these kind of toys, I think, are really important. And obviously, we're getting to the point now where we'd be able to do this in multi-dimensional and look at the details of the dynamics of some of the, well, weird solids that people are making. But also, you'll find weird things of the old-fashioned ones. Sodium chloride, find something new going on if you really can control the wave functions this well.
And for these different states, as far as like the dispersion relations go, is that where you can find where the actual bands exist between these?
You bet. What you do is you plot these energies as a function of k. So what you usually see is a parabola to start with. That's just a good old dispersion. And then as you become close to the point where the A or B boundaries are, that thing turns and makes a gap, an avoided crossing. So two hyperbolas meet there to make our two-level system funny business. The crossing and non-crossing and all that kind of stuff we talked about for an A-B model, remember?
Yeah.
Or an A-C or a B-C, right? Any mixture, or A, B, C, and D, put them all together, you're still going to get places where there are hyperbolas. Those are the avoided crossings, and going to them is called indirect band gap transitions, or involves an indirect locus of activity.
Are you leveraging off another mechanism?
Well, don't have to. Here all we've got is electrons and then a dead lattice, right? Now you start the lattice doing its stuff, and of course that's the next thing here in this business is just to do six masses. And this you can play with right now at home. This is OS9 here, but just today we got Hexagon to work on the web, and I'll go ahead and run it right now. See what we can get here.
You never emptied your cache on that one.
We may have to, yeah. Let's just try. I'll see if I can launch this and get it going. One thing I have to do is I have to give it 6 atoms. So this is a 6 atom vibrator now.
You're working from a copy of the app that was loaded yesterday or the day before, because it's in the cache. You need to go out to the server and get a new one.
Let's just see if it's okay. Slide this guy over here. Launch. It looks a little squirrely.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead and refresh the cache, because then you'll have all the user interface for doing the right clicks.
Yeah. I think this is the one that we would need, so... Let's pause here, and...
I need to crawl about 4 down.
Clear browsing data. And that is all we want to do here. And then...
Close
window. Let's go. Okay. Go back to the...
Just close that window and it'll bring you back to the previous one.
Okay.
So unfortunately, we have 3 different browsers we use.
Yeah.
They're all just a little different.
Let's try.
Reload that one and it'll work.
See if that'll work. Yeah, that is a valid thing. Now this one starts at the top. This is A1, E1, E2, B1. V2, E2, E1, and A2. So that's pretty much a canonical order. This fan is very tight. This one's getting looser, so this kind of thing gets looser to go. Basically, what we have is a very weak spring between each of the neighbors. So we have a very small K1, 0.03. Then we've got a local, this corresponds to the potential well, and the rubber band corresponds to the ability to tunnel. So, for example, this A1, the opposite of that, and I can just click on, right click on this thing and kill it, and then go down to here and just make a phaser of some kind. And that's a vibration that has both global and local anti-symmetry. Okay? It's anti-symmetric to the axis of the local coordinate system. And it's basically just a libration, which is a rotation that's vibrating. Okay? Let's zero, erase. I actually didn't have to erase because it comes up. This is the back and forth one. So it's plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus. And it is anti-symmetric, one, locally and globally. And it's one-dimensional, so you can't be both like you can with a double degenerate mode. Okay, so let's go get one of those. 0 amps. I'll leave the line it makes because it's very approximately obeying the local symmetry. Let's pick one that's a little of both. And there's a real part right there, so that's where it's going to be oscillating from. So it's got global symmetry, but local anti-symmetry. Locally anti-symmetric, it's perpendicular, that is angular as opposed to radial. And then the clash point, remember when you have symmetry and anti-symmetry, it cancels. Okay, it tends to cancel, and the tendency is pretty much because I only got 0.03 on the coupling. So this thing is barely moving, barely wiggling due to those guys. Okay, he's exhibiting a little bit of symmetric motion and practically none of the anti-symmetric motion. Same with this one over here. Okay, so that's a good example right there. And then at the same energy as this one, but I'll go ahead and zero amps before I start this one. This one should be globally anti-symmetric and locally anti-symmetric. It's globally anti-symmetric, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, well, that's minus, see? This is anti-symmetric. Two reflection all the way through globally. These two are anti. This one, of course, is anti with itself, just like that one is. Okay?
What do you mean anti-symmetric with respect to itself?
Well, symmetric corresponds to just moving on right. The axis.
Oh.
This is the main global axis, but each of those sites has a local radial axis, you see. And you're either with that or you're against it. This is anti with respect to that locality. This one is anti with respect to that locality.
So
this one is both anti with respect to the local and to the whole global line here. And all of them are anti-symmetric with respect to the global line.
So if I have these two, if the case were that I have these two guys doing this, they will be globally symmetric, right?
That would be globally symmetric, whether you did it together or
right
opposite.
The one right above
is
that
still
one.
in the global plane or axis.
Oh, okay.
You can kind of see the modes drawn there on that phasor plot, so you don't have to run it to see. There's little small models next to the
phasors.
Yeah,
it's a little hard to see that, but if I just pause this at the peak, okay, you can see where they are. See this to there, then a big distance to there. This right here should be pretty close to that. It's on the wrong side of it.
Choose the phasor that way.
Yeah.
That you wanted to do. You had one in your mind. It should be up there.
Now, if I mix these two, it should still be a stationary state.
O2, E2.
If I add a little bit of this, say in phase, This has some translation.
They're pretty stationary.
Yeah, these phasors should be in phase.
Huh?
Should be degenerate.
It makes sense because when you look at the reflection is always in phase. I mean,
that's it.
Phase, and in phase.
Yeah.
It wouldn't make sense if you look at the neighbors.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. For the global aspect.
These are a little extreme. But
you can pause them and lock them down to perfect phase match by using the user interface, the context mode.
That's true. Yeah, we can match them. I just wanted to check this one. Let's zero the amps here. I wanted to check if this one had a this one is globally symmetric. So the